Who needs Bono when you have Mike Matt, right? Well, since this is the battle for marriage and family, I thought we'd start off with a favorite prayer of mine, the prayer for children. Oh, Heavenly Father, I commend my children and grandchildren to you. Be their God and Father, and mercifully supply whatever is wanting in me through negligence. Strengthen them to overcome the corruptions of the world, to resist all solicitations to evil, whether from within or without, and deliver them from the secret snares of the enemy. Pour your grace into their hearts and confirm and multiply in them the gifts of your Holy Spirit, that they may daily grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that faithfully serving you here, they may come to rejoice in your presence hereafter. Amen. Amen. That prayer I found in my grandfather's missal on the day he died, and it was dog-eared. He had 6 children, 36 grandchildren, and I didn't inherit any money from him, but I inherited this beautiful prayer, which I treasure to this day. Well, I'm so honored to be here again, to be speaking to this group of Neo-Pelagians, rigid fundamentalists, climate change deniers, Tea Partiers, ultra-conservatives who say no to everything, you unchristian Trumpers, you rotten capitalists, you nativists, you egotistical populists, you earmuffed-wearing ideologues, you closed-heart restorationists, thank you. You resistors to change, self-referential, obstinate rebels and idolaters who obstinately can cling to what has always been done and who do not allow others to change. I could go on for the remaining hour, but let me just say that that's a love letter to all of us from the merciful Pope. I prefer to greet you according to the words of Cardinal Robert Serra. You're not enclosed in a box or in a library or in a museum of curiosities. You're not traditionalists. You're Catholics of the Roman Rite. Well, Catholics of the Roman Rite, let us pull back the curtain on the mercy mantra, eco-spirituality, UN ring-kissing, dogma-ditching, and dubia-dodging papacy. What is really going on in the Francis papacy, and what can you do to resist it? Has the world been blinded by the mercy mantra of the humble Pope? We faithful Catholics are under a vicious verbal attack by none other than the Vicar of Christ, the Pope of Mercy. But let us follow the words of St. John Chrysostom. Let us be filled with confidence and let us discard everything so as to be able to meet this onslaught. Christ has equipped us with weapons more splendid than gold, more resistant than steel, weapons more fiery than any flame and lighter than the slightest breeze. These are the weapons of a totally new kind, for they have been forged for a previously unheard type of combat. March 13th, 2013, a day that will live in infamy. In the background, the infamous Belgian Cardinal Daniels of the St. Gallen Mafia, gazing smugly from the loggia of St. Peter's at the crowd, surely thinking, oh, you Christians, you don't know what's in store for the church with this newly elected pope. Truly, the climate, pun intended, radically changed overnight at the Vatican. The simpering servitude to the new world order, that's Chris Ferrara's line. It's just so good. I had to use it in this slide. Together, they share Pope Francis and George Soros and promote the lofty utopian goals of the global elites, one with his money and the other from his papal throne. From the moment Francis stepped out into the loggia, his actions have mirrored the agenda of the UN and its New World oligarchs. Today, I will give you a brief introduction of what is commonly referred to as the New World Order, forged from the Illuminati, from the Freemasons, now morphed into globalism, which is in its final stages of implementation. I want to highlight the players, the funders, the organizing principles, and the stated and unstated goals of the architects of the New World Order. And a proper discussion of this complex structure and movement would require a year-long college course, so I'm just going to give you a brief survey. And by the way, in my opinion, the events are happening so fast at lightning speed in the Vatican that I need to update this speech, you know, nearly on a daily basis. But today I want to demonstrate that the globalists of the New World Order have found in the person of Jorge Bergoglio their long sought after moral voice, who would echo and bless its sustainable goals and carry out its most insidious and pernicious goal, one world religion. Finally, I hope to demonstrate that the lessons learned from historical resistance movements will give us hope and are the path forward for our present resistance movement, one well underway by the faithful Catholics here and around the globe. I'm not a conspiracy devotee, but in November of 2013, 6 months into the Bergoglio papacy, I attended the Human Trafficking Conference at the Pontifical Academy of Social Science right inside the Vatican. From the moment I stepped into that building, I was deeply disturbed and confounded by the globalist language I heard coming from all the attendees and speeches. I met Pope Francis. I observed him, and I watched carefully the machinations at what was happening at the Pontifical Academy of what I now call Socialist Sciences. It was then that I began my 5-year investigative research about the men behind the papal curtain and their incessant parade of globalist experts propounding population control and UN globalism. I'd like to share with you the Soros Green Team, who are embedded at the Vatican. This is the dream team of George Soros on the far left, appropriately at the World Economic Forum in Davos, Switzerland, where all the globalists meet. In the middle is Joe Stiglitz. Joe Stiglitz is an economist from Columbia University. He is also the founder, I kid you not, of the International Socialist Conference. He is also a longtime member of the Pontifical Academy of Social Sciences. And on the far right is Jeffrey Sachs. He is, again, an economist from Columbia University, a UN bureaucrat who has spoken at the conference at the Vatican 21 times. He is, in fact, has written some documents on the environmental issues coming out of the Vatican. This is Soros's, as I like to call it, their green team. At the heart of the global agenda is godlessness, a usurpation of power to manipulate lives. In 1990 in Czechoslovakia, John Paul II bluntly criticized the New World Order globalists. He said, "They claim to build a world without God, which has been shown to be an illusion. Such a hope has already revealed itself as a tragic utopia, for man is unable to be happy if the transcendent relationship with God is excluded." Even Investors Daily in a recent editorial, recognized the leftward embrace of the Vatican, that it's been infiltrated by followers of a radical green movement that at its core is anti-Christian, anti-people, anti-poor, anti-development. Jeffrey Sachs has now come out of his, you know, dark cloud and has really began, they've now began talking about the New World Order after decades of operating in secrecy, making their plans without the rest of us knowing what's going on. The New World Order, he promises, will be a wonderful world. Now, for penance, I've read, and you may thank me, all of Jeffrey Sachs' speeches at the Vatican and his countless books. One of my favorites is The End of Poverty, or as I like to call it, The End of Poverty by Ending Babies, or The End of Poverty for Only the Globalists. You will see on grand display two opposites at play, and this has been coming out of the Vatican and in encyclicals reflecting the language of the globalists. And here it is. Catastrophe is looming. We are at the tipping point because of climate change and global warming. As Sachs says, the globe is bursting at the seams with too many people. Those are a few of Jeffrey Sachs's Chicken Little, the Sky is Falling gems. But then they come up and they say, but we have the promise to save the world if you will only follow what we tell you to do. And those are the UN Sustainable Development Goals, which have been in place for decades. They've never reached their goal, but these are the goals that the globalists want us to adopt. Sachs is your classic globalist, the uber expert on everything, the compassionate con, as he's often called, the UN bureaucrat at the Soros money trough his entire life, who writes books about ending poverty, and the only poverty he ends is his own. And like most globalists, the financial rewards are massive. Sachs just bought last year a $6.25 million New York City townhome. Quite an end to his poverty. If you are thinking this sounds a lot like socialism, you're right. The oligarchs make all the money. Enter Joe Stiglitz, who you saw his picture, the member of the Pontifical Academy, and his Socialist International Foundation was funded by who else? George Soros. Joe Stiglitz, he tackles the global financial problems. Jeff Sachs handles the environmental crisis, and George Soros funds and dispenses billions to create the chaos which destabilizes the world so that the New World Order globalists may come in and save us all. This is David Rockefeller, who's the granddaddy of the New World Order. We're on the verge of a global transformation. All we need, get this, listen to this, all we need is the right major crisis and the nations will accept the New World Order. So they're making no secret of what their plan is. As Jeff Sachs told the BBC, the New World Order is going to be wonderful. We are in, he says, the middle of a profound change. No question about it. If we're smart, and oh, if we're lucky, we will get to something very good. So if that isn't a sales pitch, I don't know what is. And David Rockefeller and his minions like the Rothschilds and all the globalists at the Davos Foundation believe that tyranny and domination in the hands of the few is the goal of the New World Order. All we need is a crisis to usher it in. And then all the useful idiots will just fall into line. And that's where Soros and his billions are so indispensable. The goal of the New World Order is the concentration of power and wealth in the hands of a few, the elitists, and the redistribution of wealth to the UN in their New World Order bureaucracy. But to accomplish this, they must eliminate poverty in Africa by eliminating the poor in Africa. They need to depopulate the world because we're sharing resources, sharing dreams, no borders, no states, no disease, no poverty, no wars. Just trust the New World Order globalists. They're called other things too, so keep your ears open. They're transnationalists, they're internationalists, all sounds very glamorous. They're globalists. They meet regularly at the Bretton Woods, Davos, the Council on Foreign Relations, Bilderberg, Agenda 21. The Rockefellers, the Rothschilds, Soros, the Kissingers, the titans in business, banking, and media. This is their plan. And what is their language? And this is why it's so important to teach your kids to be critical thinkers. Here are the words they use in their language. Common. Dialogue. Sustainable. Shared. Utopia. As an example, you know how many times in Laudate Si, the papal eco-encyclical, they use the word common? He used the word common 57 times. Their constitution is the Earth Charter and the UN Declaration on Human Rights. Their enabling legislation is the Sustainable Development Goals. Their bureaucracy, the UN. Their bank, the IMF and the World Bank. Their funding mechanism, taxation under the Paris Climate Treaty. Their goals, utopia world of no poverty and no war. And their God and religion, the earth and nature, and elimination of all traditional religions. The New World Order project, which has been in the shadows for decades, if not centuries, requires a hook to consolidate the world's power in the hands of a few powerful oligarchs, elites. And the hook is, as Gordon Brown says, the climate change is the global crisis key to unlock the New World Order. Climate change is the key. Manufacture a phony crisis, then demand a New World Order to fix it. That faux crisis is climate change. If the faux crisis doesn't work, they will stage a real crisis. I've read the proceedings of all the UN population conferences going well back into the 1980s, when they had that aha moment, when all of a sudden, as they're arguing for global abortion and contraception in all the countries of the world, and they're not getting anywhere, the feminists and the radical lefts and the globalists, and they're not getting anywhere because the Vatican small little team was battling them every step of the way. This was Benedict and John Paul's team that he would send to that they would send to all the population control meetings. In fact, the feminists had a button made at one of the conferences. They were so exhausted and frustrated by the Vatican fighting them tooth and nail over abortion and contraception. And their button said, "I'm poped out." I don't think they're going to be making those buttons anymore. But in that aha moment, when they're not getting anywhere with their arguments about abortion, they realize, global warming that covers the world. Mankind is responsible for the terrible tragedy of global warming. And so this will be our hook to impose the New World Order. Of course, global warming morphed into climate change, which morphed into sustainable development, which morphed into extreme weather events. Every time the scientists are able to disprove their theories, they come up with another name. George Soros is the billionaire globalist atheist, the most hated man in the world, supposedly the most dangerous man in the world, understands the opportunities abound in disorder. With his billions, he creates disorder and chaos in the world and capitalizes on the chaos. He is the architect and benefactor nearly of every revolution and coup around the world in the last 25 years. He dispenses his wealth to leftist causes like ACORN, Planned Parenthood, the ACLU, Media Matters, MoveOn.org, Antifa, Black Lives Matter, Occupy Wall Street, just to name a few. Over a decade ago, though, George Soros, with typical hubris, bragged that he was so powerful, he was the Pope's boss now. Well, you laugh about that. I don't laugh about that anymore. It appears that it's become a self-fulfilling prophecy. The Unholy Alliance, this profane partnership, unites Soros, the most dangerous man in the world, with the other, the Vicar of Christ. George Soros spent $500 million to foment the chaotic and violent Muslim migration into Europe and America. He spent $33 million on Black Lives Matter and Antifa. And recently, the Wall Street Journal reported that he switched all of his money, $18 billion, into his Open Society Foundation. So get ready for $18 billion worth of chaos. This is one of his famous quotes. The world needs a new world order, and I'm here to alert you that we are entering a period of world disorder thanks to his millions. Sobering comment from George Soros. He's a citizen of the United States. Can you imagine making that comment? There's the Vatican's favorite economist, Jeffrey Sachs, Ban Ki-moon, the former Secretary General of the UN, and George Soros. The New World Order has had its globalists, it had its agenda, it's had its funding, and it had its mechanism to make all this happen. And this all developed within the last century. But it lacked one important ingredient. The New World Order had no moral leader. Leonardo DiCaprio wasn't going to fit the bill. Al Gore certainly wasn't going to fit the bill. But that now has been solved. In the brilliant and prophetic, St. Pope Pius X said, and he understood about what was happening and what would be happening in the future. He said, the great movement of apostasy being organized in every country for the establishment of one world church, which will have neither dogmas nor hierarchy, neither discipline for the mind nor curb for the passion, and which, under the pretext of freedom and human dignity, would bring back to the world the reign of legalized cunning and force and the oppression of the weak. Indeed, the true friends of the people are neither revolutionaries nor innovators. The true friends of the people are the traditionalists. And so the Holy See was infiltrated, or more likely invited in, by the Soros shadow cabinet, his brain trust, his inner circle, his trusted facilitators. And they expedited, in a way that was absolutely unimaginable, the climate change agenda of population control. These are the operatives. These are just a few of the Soros operatives in the Vatican. Partha Dupka, again, been associated with Soros, Jeff Sachs, Joe Stiglitz, Peter Raven, one of the friends, close friends and collaborator of Paul Ehrlich, and of course Emma Bonino, the Kermit Gosnell of Italy, the abortionist who is responsible for many, personally responsible for many abortions in Italy. Pope Francis called her a great friend. And Francis has also invited into the Vatican, not only is he carrying out their agenda, but Ban Ki-moon and others, obviously, there's Leo DiCaprio, Mark Zuckerberg, Tim Cook of Apple, I think, Melinda Gates, baptized Catholic. Christine Lagarde of, I think she was in the World Bank. Hollywood. Angela Merkel, the globalist. The head of, I think, the EU. And, of course, America's globalist, Jerry Brown, who was invited to talk at the Pontifical Academy, of course, along with Bernie Sanders and others. The goal of the New World Order is one world leader, one world government, one world currency, and one world religion. Now, how does one create one world religion, especially with the, you know, the strong, powerful, universal Catholic Church? And one of the ways of doing it is to invite an interfaith dialogue, is to bring in the all the various religions and say, we're all the same, we all love the same God. And that was the responsibility of Jorge Bergoglio in his One World Religion. The Earth Charter is the charter that is followed by the Sustainable Development Goals. So we also have kind of our constitution already in place for the globalists. Here are the goals, the Sustainable Development Goals, and actually Michael Hitchborn of Lepanto has done great work in this area. Number 3 and number 5 are really about the gender bending, contraceptive coding, abortion-laden goals of the Sustainable Development Initiative that is fomented and pushed by the United Nations. And here's a hint. The Millennial Development Goals from 2000 to 2015 were all the same, and the UN never met those goals. So now they reissued same goals, new name, slicker graphics, and still pushing the abortion agenda around the world. The New World Order is really crudely and brutally about global depopulation. This is the quote of Pope Leo, or maybe Pope Pius X, excuse me. Global depopulation. Here we have Bill Gates, Rockefeller, Bush, Kissinger, Brzezinski, Rockefeller, another younger Rockefeller. Yeah, Cardinal Turkson was talking about how important the timing of the climate encyclical. And the question is why do they want fewer people? Why do they want global depopulation? And many of the people who have talked at the Vatican have answered that question, especially Dr. Johann Schellenhuber. He's a great believer that the 7.2 billion people on the planet right now should be reduced to 1 billion. And he was recently appointed the brand new member of Francis's Pontifical Academy of Sciences. You see, it's much cheaper to provide a global minimum wage to 1 billion people than it is to 7 billion people. It's much cheaper and easier to control 1 billion people than it is 7.2 billion people. In our Christian country, whose constitution acknowledges that our gifts flow from our Creator, God Almighty, not the government, we must rise up in opposition to the totalitarian nature of the world government, which puts power in the hands of a few. This is why Soros has invested millions to create his chaos. Because in chaos, the people become afraid and become vulnerable to a new world order imposing order. You know, G.K. Chesterton warned that when men lose their faith in God, they end up believing not in nothing, but in anything. Climate change is that anything. The UN is that anything. Sustainable development is that anything. Abortion is that anything. Same-sex marriage is that anything. That anything is the phony so-called science that man causes global warming. It's nothing more than the globalist cloud cover to obscure the rampant, bloody agenda to butcher babies, slash fertility, and control our lives. And along comes Francis, who crafts an eco-exhortation with the help of the globalist Jeff Sachs and his cabal. Laudate si, on care of our common home. I'm going to zip through these slides. This is the Barnum and Bailey Bergoglio Laser Show.
Images of clouds, lions, and butterflies alternating with polluted air and parched farmland were projected on the famous facade of St. Peter's Basilica at the Vatican on Tuesday night as global leaders tried to thrash out a historic climate deal in Paris. The light show, titled Fiat Lux, Let There Be Light Illuminating Our Common Home, also coincided with the festive launch Tuesday of a special Catholic Jubilee year on the theme of mercy. Thousands of people thronged St. Peter's Square for the hour-long light show featuring the work of some of the world's best photographers, including Sebastião Salgado of Brazil, Joel Sartor of the United States, and Frenchman Yann Arthus Bertrand. The images were accompanied not by music but by the sounds of nature, such as stormy weather, birdsong, and long stretches of silence. The initiative, backed by the World Bank, aims to underscore the Catholic Church's push for environmental protection. Pope Francis, a fierce defender of the environment, warned leaders at the start of the two-week conference of the parties, COP21, talks in Paris on November 30th, that it was now or never for international leaders to seal a deal to slow global warming.
Pretty slick, isn't it? $1 million from the World Bank, which is the largest supporter of worldwide abortion. Not to celebrate the glorious feast day on December 8th of the Immaculate Conception, no. It's to celebrate the upcoming passage of the Paris Climate Treaty. Man is not an endangered species, despite the hundreds of millions of children killed by global abortion. No, the monkeys and the butterflies are the species we should protect. The clerical eco-radicals graciously donated the facade, the holy facade of St. Peter's, to look like a glitzy National Geographic circus, funded, as I mentioned, to the tune of $1 million. But this video captures the visual, digital, Madison Avenue propaganda, which is now employed by the Francis Vatican globalists to appropriate the most sacred of our churches, to peddle and hawk eco-lies of endangered species and global warming. Pay attention to the glitzy, un-Catholic, papal props that promote the globalist agenda. And look at this next video. You will see no symbols of the faith. And it's basically what I would call a digital dogma disinformation campaign. Very effectively used to lure the Catholic faithful into dumbing down the faith and making globalism, environmentalism, and one world religion a new palatable dogma. This is Francis's idea of dialogue. And of course, you know, I'm very distressed because as I talk about, you see the impact of an environmental exhortation, that it really does impact people's knowledge of what's really dangerous and what we should be concerned about. Propaganda has consequences. Animals are more endangered than Christians. The environment is more endangered than Christians. The Paris Treaty passed, and who was there? Of course, Jeff Sachs. There they are, the globalists, celebrating the Paris Climate Treaty, which in effect would have great taxation on all the various governments around the world, meaning us. Here's Ban Ki-moon thanking the Pope for his support of the UN Sustainable Development Goals. Now, Tim Worth is a longtime Democratic ambassador, State Department employee. He used to have a condom tree in his office. Look what he has to say about this. We've got to ride this global warming issue, even if the theory of global warming is wrong. Even if it's wrong, we will be doing the right thing in terms of economic and environmental policy. Recently he said, we've never seen a pope do anything like this. No one has so much global sway as Pope Francis. On the rise, one world religion. Professor Michel Suens, who is a very close collaborator with John Paul II, noted about the Earth Charter. He said, listen to this, religions in general, and in the first place, the Catholic religion, figure among the most strongest obstacles that must be neutralized. The goal is the creation of one unique new world religion that would entail right away the prohibition of proselytism on the part of all other religions. You'll recall Pope Francis's outreach to Lutherans, to the Chinese, to Islam in light of this statement. The grave sin, of course, that he told us of proselytizing. It's not, oops, I lost that, but it's not licit to proselytize, he told us. You see the gradual weaning away of the religion. What about Jesus' admonition? Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son. Here's the New World Order. They even have a flag, the coexist flag. You'll notice all religions are the same. All the religions will coexist. This was an actual online panel discussion that was had. Make friends. as if we're in kindergarten, right? Make friends. How deep and how theological and profound is that? Let's just make friends. Isn't that what we were taught in kindergarten? And I'm sure many of you have heard Pope Francis's defense of Islam against the accusation of violence and terrorism. If I talk about Islamic terrorism and violence, then I must talk about Catholic violence. And of course, here's Bishop Sirondo of the Pontifical Academy saying that China is the best implementer of Catholic social doctrine. I mean, it's madness when you begin to see as this continues to pick up steam. He praised the extraordinary communist state. We heard last night what Cardinal Zen had to say about that. Watch this.
La mayor parte de los habitantes del planeta se declaran creyentes. Esto debería provocar un diálogo entre las religiones. No debemos dejar de orar por él y colaborar con quienes piensan distinto.
Confío en Buda.
Creo en Dios.
Creo en Jesucristo.
Creo en Dios. Alá.
Muchos piensan distinto, sienten distinto, buscan a Dios o encuentran a Dios de diversa manera. En esta multitud, en este abanico de religiones, hay una sola certeza que tenemos para todos. Todos somos hijos de Dios.
Creo en el amor.
Creo en el amor.
Creo en el amor.
Creo en el amor.
Confío en vos para difundir.
Notice the crucifix is covered.
El diálogo sincero entre hombres y mujeres de diversas religiones conlleve frutos de paz y justicia. Confío en tu oración.
Okay, I'm sure you noticed when the Pope, this is the Pope's monthly intentional video, very slick, not one image of the Catholic Church. No crucifix, he hid his crucifix. There was no rosary, those were Buddhist beads. The supposed symbol of the Catholic Church was a little baby, right? That's about as close as they would get. It's slick, it's subtle, it's the lovely music in the background. It's to lure us into the one world religion. We're going to continue to see more and more of this from the church, and we have to be attuned to this happening and make our kids aware, because you can, all love, Amoris Laetitia, we all love each other. And this is what gives me great concern, is that the money spent, the globalists that are jumping in to assist on this. After watching that video, nobody can deny that the Vatican is openly advocating for one world order, one religion. And the propaganda, it's subtle. It's not at the butt of a gun. It's the music, it's the images, it's the laughing. And then there's the problematic obstacle towards one world religion, Catholic dogma and magisterium. No worries. Francis drenches it in the process and is watering it down in the Catholic dogma to eliminate any barriers between the Catholic Church and others' religion. After all, he's the merciful Pope. Sprinkle a little mercy and a little love on the human condition and deconstruct the faith in a footnote. All religion and people will ultimately partake in our sacraments without the benefit of conversion. One of the speakers at the Rockefeller population event was a Dr. Day, who was an avowed atheist, and he said these words: once the Roman Catholic Church is brought down, the rest of Christianity will follow easily. Then a new world religion can be accepted for use all over the world. It will incorporate something from all of the religions and make it easy for people to accept it and make them feel at home. Most people won't be too concerned with religion. They will realize that they don't need it. That's what they're up to, folks. And they're using these digital video media encyclicals, the Mercy Pope. It's all staged to roll out the New World Order. George Soros serves as the boss of Pope Francis. His directive is carried out with precision. The Echo encyclical, released with precision and timing. It blesses the SDGs and the Paris Climate Treaty, the reduction of all major religions into one, and the blessing of the migration invasion. Much more is planned from the Holy See. And in the face of this onslaught from Holy Mother Church, arising seemingly out of nowhere in particular, but everywhere in general. But the Catholic resistance is underway. And we are building a Catholic resistance. That uncomfortable and up to now alien word for the faithful, resistance. You know, the Brazilian thinker, man of action, who wrote a leaflet objecting to the Vatican's Ostolopique when they were reaching out to Russia. And he wrote this about resistance. And I hope you can keep this in mind, because I think this will gird you for the battle. A resistance is not a separation, nor a revolt, nor acrimony, nor irreverence. On the contrary, resistance is fidelity, union, love, and submission. Resistance is the word we have chosen on purpose, as it has been used by St. Paul himself to describe his stance. Since the first Pope, St. Peter, had taken disciplinary measures to retain practices in the Catholic faith which survived the ancient synagogue, St. Paul saw it to be a grave risk of doctrinal confusion. So he rose up and he resisted St. Peter. Building the resistance movement, and hopefully each one of you will find your acts of resistance. Of course, the famous Bonhoeffer quote, "Silence in the face of evil is evil itself. God will not hold us guiltless. Not to speak is to speak. Not to act is to act." The Vendée, the symbols and patches of the Vendée during the 17th century, the whole of Western France was stirred by the mission of St. Louis de Montfort and the red badge of his Sacred Heart, popularized by the saint. That Catholic symbol served as an important badge of honor because years later, during the French Revolution, as Michael had pointed out, when the churches were wiped out, one of the first actions by the revolution was to de-establish the Catholic Church, nationalizing church property, abolishing monasteries, forcing priests to swear allegiance to the Republican government. Priests who refused to swear were ejected from their parishes. They were forced to emigrate. The terror engulfed France starting in 1793. But the Vendée, they were a ragtag group of Catholic army made up of farmers and peasants who defied the odds in battling the professional revolutionaries of the French army. When the Vendées won a battle, the bells of the churches rang out in celebration, and the Catholic army sang a Te Deum in thanksgiving. The distinctive signs of the Vendée were the long rosary that they wore in battle and the Sacred Heart patch that they wore on their uniform. Devout Catholicism was part of what drove these counter-revolutionaries. None of the men, and sometimes even the woman who fought beside them, were professional soldiers, but they made up for it in courage, what they lacked in discipline. The Vendée army grew throughout the terror. Their devotion to the faith and their religion was ardent. If they were advancing in combat along a road and came across a small roadside, small shrine with a crucifix, they would immediately kneel in prayer for a moment, continuing then on to their advance. Their devotion in their homes was equally strong. During the Easter season of 1793, they deserted the battle lines en masse and went home and went to church services during Easter. One Vendean soldier captured the fervor of these mighty fighters. "They have killed our king. They have chased away our good priests. They have sold our goods. They have taken everything. They have eaten everything we have. And now they want to take away our bodies. No, they shall not have them." These peasants who fought the revolutionaries were known throughout the church and across France as those exemplary Catholics. And these peasants took up arms against evil in what was described as the Last Crusade. We know about the resistance in World War II. We know about the Christian symbols that popped up all around Europe, the Cross of Lorraine, the resistance movement shield. On every street corner and on walls, the underground, the resistance movement would paint it, sometimes in chalk. That was their symbol to fight the evil Nazi government. During World War II, when the German armies marched over six nations in Western Europe, Denmark, Norway, Luxembourg, Holland, and then France, the citizens were stunned. They were terrified and largely leaderless. However, the resistance began immediately to organize, largely without leaders or consultation. They were acts of defiance, big and small. As the war waged on, the resistors, with their symbols of resistance written on as graffiti on walls, the V for victory, the Cross de Lorraine in France. In every country, the resistance began to multiply its activities with the goal of providing and relaying intelligence of the German troop movements to the British and American allies. The resistance quietly, bravely, cleverly sabotaged the advance of the German army. They developed an underground clandestine press in Holland. Thousands of newspapers would be circulating with news of the Allies' events and the secret codes. An underground network of clandestine intelligence would supply the movement of Hitler's army. Secret messages were smuggled into toothpaste and in the tubes of bicycles. Now that is the Catholic imagination. Critical to the resistance movement were false papers for the Allied pilots who were shot down by the Germans, and those were expertly crafted by the Catholic monks. There were massive escape lines and secret networks that smuggled over 1,000 British and American airmen back to safety, many hiding them in monasteries and churches and convents. The heroism and daring and brazen courage of ordinary citizens, young, old, teenagers, children, old people, saved thousands of Jews and played a critical role in the Allied victory. Even General Eisenhower said, "But for the resistance movement, World War II would continue on for years." Archbishop Saliège of Toulouse operated a network which located Catholic homes and convents for Jewish children. It was estimated that 300,000 French Jews were saved because of the resistance movement. Cardinal Joseph Rouillé, Belgium's chief prelate, ordered all Catholic institutions in the country to take in hunted Jews. One resistance fighter who was shot down by Germans but continued to work in the resistance nevertheless, more determined than ever, continued working, saying, "I was scared all the time. I think everyone was. Fear was a daily reality, but we forged ahead, determined to reclaim our land. I urge you to read about the 2,500 Catholic priests in Dachau concentration camp and how they dedicated their camp to Mary, Mother Thrice Admirable, how hosts were smuggled in so that they could have a daily Eucharistic adoration hour after the brutal and exhausting work of the concentration camp, how they risked contracting typhoid and other diseases in order to provide last rites to dying camp prisoners. While over 800 priests perished at Dachau, some succumbing to starvation and disease, these brave men were suffering from exhaustion, but they did not succumb to the taunts, the bribes, and the cruelties of their captors. The story of their fervent and unwavering faith should give us the faith of a powerful resistance. Jesus' words to Saint Faustina about the call to resistance, I think, are very powerful. I will not delude you with prospects of peace and consolation. On the contrary, prepare for great battles. As we know, St. Faustina suffered physically and spiritually. She was prepared for great battles by the grace of God. God told her to fight like a knight, so I can reward you. Do not be unduly fearful, because you are not alone. Our Lord's words to St. Faustina should be our mantra. Fight like a knight. A knight for Christ knows well the cause that he fights for, the nobility of his mission, the king who he serves, and with blessed assuredness of the victory. Interestingly enough, the resistance has arrived with respect to this papacy. On a cool February Saturday in Rome, on February 4th, 2017, the citizens of Rome woke to a spectacular enough, well, actually to an earthquake, almost like the Norcia earthquake. No one knew it was coming. Executed with military precision, operating in the dead of night, swiftly, quietly, surely, patiently plotting this campaign. No one was caught, no one was arrested. It took a great deal of planning to put these posters up. And in the morning, in Rome, these posters shook Rome and the church to its core. But on that day, I say that the resistance movement took hold in Roma, like the extravagant network of resistors in World War II who papered the skies and streets and train stations with symbols of resistance and leaflets. The Roman resistors seemingly came out of the catacombs with the fervor of the sainted martyrs, like swift-footed ghosts, like avenging angels, delivering a message from the tombs of the martyrs of Rome. With gladiator speed, we are here. We will resist. We will prevail. The aftershocks were felt around the world. The resistance movement is growing. Here's some more. They were plastered all over Rome, and no one was ever caught.
What did they say?
No one was tipped off.
No, what did they,
what did they say?
They said, you and your, basically your mercy talk, you're not merciful to the dubia, you will not answer the dubia, so much for your mercy. You know, that was basically, I think basically that was it. And of course, the dubia, ignored and unanswered. One million Polish Catholics who gathered on the border to pray the Rosary Crusade. Here they are on the border, lining the sea, praying their rosary. Here's another picture. Just really, really inspiring. Here's another picture of men lining the sea. But, oh, make friends, right? During World War II, thousands of people went underground, not to hide, but to organize, to plot, to resist, to protest, to undermine, to give voice to truth, and to act to risk their lives for their country, their family, and even for strangers. Do we not owe that effort for the Mother of God whose church is under siege? Carol Wotewa was ordained in an underground seminary. Anton Schneider, Bishop of Kazakhstan, received his first communion in secret. When I think of the present day Belgian Cardinal Gottfried Daniels, who covered up for his fellow predator bishop, in stark contrast to World War II's Belgian Cardinal Rouy, who was known as the Iron Bishop for his strong leadership in the face of the relentless Nazi intimidation, or the brave and bold leadership of French Cardinal Saliège of Toulouse, who organized the Garrels Circuit. And that circuit was the underground network for Jewish children smuggled out of France. I urge you to let the words of Archbishop Saliège resonate in your hearts. I don't know exactly what must be done, but I know something must. I have faith that each of you, praying and open to the Holy Spirit, will be directed to a path of holiness and heroism. The resistance is here, and this is just a slice of all the things that have been happening in the last 5 years and will continue to grow.
Turn around.
list is growing. Hold on. So, there's much hope to be had, and we must not be cowed or silenced in the face of relentless public shaming by the pontiff or his cohorts. Certainly, we will suffer the slings and arrows of insults, but we must derive strength instead from the brave words of the resistance fighter. We had to look at not at what we lost, but what we saved. God called us to do this work, and he also gave us the strength for it. We could not do otherwise. For the last 5 years, a small global band of truth tellers, Catholic bloggers, who with no organization, no power, no money, a house full of children, and mounting bills to pay, battled the global elites and their megastar pope. Your seemingly small and inconsequential voice has broken through to the world. Your powerful witness ensures when the history of this papacy is written, your powerful and unstinting voice of courage, your fervor, and your love for Holy Mother Church will drown out the empty and dangerous papacy. And like the Vandeans of the 18th century, they will say of you, they are the exemplary Catholics. My friends, never forget that we are fighting for our holy religion. And to the young people here, this is and will continue to be your fight. Take heart in the many battles that have been won by young people. David DeLeiden, 28 years old, the dragon slayer of Planned Parenthood. James O'Keefe, 30 years old, the undercover journalist videographer who exposed Planned Parenthood, Acorn, and the Soros Network. Lila Rose, the 29-year-old founder of Live Action, pro-life activist who exposed the behemoth Planned Parenthood. We need you young people to join the fight. We need your ideas, your commitment. St. Therese wrote in her letter to her sister Celine, sanctity, it has to be won at the point of a sword. God has granted me the grace not to fear the battle. I must do my duty at all costs. And in her autobiography, she writes, Lord God of armies, you said in your gospel, I came to bring not peace, but a sword. Arm me for the struggle, Lord. I yearn to fight for your glory. I beg for your strength. The day of victory is coming, the day that will save the kingdom. But to God alone belongs all the glory. To prove it, he arms the arm of a child. How much do we love the child, the God child, the unborn child? That is the question we must face with this unimaginable battle within our beloved church. It's time to fight by arming ourselves with rosaries and the truth. And be not afraid. Our Lady of Fatima, pray for us. Can you please stand and let's sing Salve Regina to our Blessed Mother.